the elasticity of a polymer is. We know that for the GNM, one of the specificities that we can induce some supercoiling and have the formation of some plectonics. We did get some orders of magnitudes for the forces that I require, and maybe I would like to get another idea about the force. I would like you to give me an idea about the weight of a bacteria. Okay? You know what is the weight of a human being? But maybe you don't know what is the weight of a bacteria. But you know that if you take something to weight that is exerting a force that is too strong, you may break something, okay? So we may have something that is not sensitive enough to detect it. So we could finish by saying that it has no weight. So how can we tackle this problem?
So you can make an assumption that the density of a human being is the same density as a bacteria, and then you know, like, you can estimate the volume of the human being, and then you know that the bacteria is around, like, I guess the volume of it is 100 microns, order of magnitude.
Yeah, this is the idea.
And then you would just
like the spherical cone, this is what we need. So, on the size of the bacteria.
100 microns in volume?
50 microns. I mean, you may find bacteria that are very large, but most of them are humicolon. Okay, so the volume 10 to the minus 18. You mentioned the density.
You might assume that it is the density of water.
It's about the density of water. So the weight of the bacteria is, so we need to multiply by gravity. We are going to assume that it's a sphere with a typical size that is a micron, and we multiply this by the density. So this is on the order of 1, 10 to the minus 18, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 50. So this is about 10 to the minus 14 newtons, which is 10 to the minus 2 piconewtons. Okay? So there are a few elements that are quite surprising. I mentioned yesterday that the molecular motors, so the enzymes that do work on biomolecules are typically able to exert forces that are few piconewtons and even few tens of piconewtons. So you see that inside the bacteria that has a weight that is 10 to the minus 2 piconewtons, you have motors, molecules that are able to exert forces that are much, much higher than this value. So keep that number in mind because I may come back to this point later. Okay, so we mentioned different ways of exerting such forces. So we fit something like an AFM-like system. We have the optical tweezers that we heard quite a lot about. And now I'm going to discuss the specific case of the magnetic tweezers. So the idea is that you can buy easily, they are not that expensive, bits that do contain some magnetic materials, and their size can be from few nanometers to few tens of micrometers, and the typical size that you need to use in micromanipulation experiments is typically 1 micron. So the experiment, what we have is that we simply attach, because as I mentioned during the first lecture, you have many ways of modify bases so that they can bind to different objects. You can modify the DNA so that it can bind to a magnetic bead that you can buy also, and the other extremity can bind to a surface that could be a glass that you have functionalized. You can observe the system with a microscope objective, and since the object is magnetic, you simply have to put magnets, permanent magnets, on top of the sample to exert a force. So you could, and this is at some point something that we did, you could use some electromagnetic fields. The problem is that usually they don't produce gradients and fields that are strong enough. So usually you need, in order to include that, you use magnetic materials inside the core of your coil. And when you have this, you know that you have this hysteresis that is present in magnetic material. So in fact, it's difficult to control exactly the field that you have, and so you need to put some feedback on the current to have the field that you want. So in the end, it does not tend to be so convenient, and so using simple magnets is much, much easier and much more convenient. Because, as it was mentioned, you can buy them since they can be used as toys, even though you're not supposed to swallow them, but you can buy them. Usually we don't have small kids in labs, so that's not so pretty. Okay, so what does the experiment look like? You have the DNA that you want to prepare. So this one is not exactly the double-strand DNA that I didn't present until now. This is a hairpin. This is a construct where you have a single-strand part here that continues here, and here you have a sequence that's complementary to that one. So the molecule falls back, and then you go to you have a single strand. So you can modify the extremities. Okay. Then you can bind that to a paramagnetic bead that is, as I said, typically 1 micron in diameter. You inject that into a sample. So what you want in the end is that you want to have a single polymer that is attached to a single bead. So most you mix a solution of beads and DNA, and you want to have much more beads than DNA, because in the end you want the probability to have 2 DNA molecules on one bead. You want this probability to be small. So most of them undergo Brownian motion. Then if you rinse, the beads that are not attached will flow away, and you have some beads that have some Brownian motion and that are going to be attached to a single DNA molecule. So you cannot get rid of the van der Waals interaction and all the interactions that you may have between the polymer and the surface. So in the sample you have few beads that are having a Brownian motion that you are going to be able to manipulate, but you may also have some beads that are non-specifically attached to the surface.
How you flush this away? So you have some microfluidic setup, or this is just the beginning?
Very fancy microfluidic setups, meaning that we take double-sided tape, we cut a piece in the middle, and we stick it. In fact, it's very convenient. You can find double-sided tapes that are that have a thickness of 20-25 microns. So this is very simple, and you can laser cut to make the cell that you want. So it's what is going to be important for us, and that maybe it's a bit early to say that. But why do we have a force on the magnetic bead that in fact is a magnetic dipole? Okay, let's consider that the magnetic bead is a magnetic dipole. Why do you have a force on that? Why a magnetic field allows to get a force on the dipole? Is it always the case?
Do you mean like a torque?
Well, what is the relation between the torque and the magnetic field and the magnetic dipole?
The cross product.
So let's write it here. And the cross product is here. What is important for the force? You may think about
gradient.
This is a gradient that's going to be important. Okay, so what is important is the gradient. So in our system, we want to have a high gradient for the magnetic field. Okay. So what we do is that we want a field that varies very quickly, okay? Because we want a high force and with the smallest distance as possible. And I'll come back to that one later. So we want to have a large gradient, and so we want to have the magnetic field that decreases quickly, and so we want to have a cell that is very thin, okay? So that we can get the magnet as close as possible to the bead, so that we have a high gradient, and so that we can have a high force on a given dipole, okay? So it's not that fancy. And we simply put a plastic sheet on the top, and you can find mylar, for example, that are only a few microns thick, and so it's very cheap, but efficient. Okay, then you place magnets on the top. You see that you have a pulley here that allows to rotate, so the bead will not only have a force because you have a gradient, but because the field is oriented in the plane, it will rotate with the bead, okay? Just like a compass follows the north field, the north pole. So if you rotate the magnets, you are going to rotate the bead. And so you are going to be able to generate supercurrent. Okay? What is critical is that we want to measure distances that are only a few nanometers. So the experimental problem that you face when you want to measure on long term such small distances is that you have the dilation of materials with temperature. So in a room, because we stay here for a few hours with some computers that do work, the temperature is going to increase, okay? So it means that if you have a material, it will expand, except that if it's made of polymer or it will shrink, okay? And so it means that you want to measure a displacement from the surface that is few nanometers, but if you are on a microscope that moves by few micrometers, it's gonna be a problem. So this is why we thermoregulate our system. And so this is the old version of our setup. Here you have the sample, the magnets that are on motors. Here you have the objective, you have a lens, you have a camera. So it's a very simple system. The camera sends the image on the computer and see, you see the images of the beads. And for sure, because DNA is very small, you cannot see it, we can observe only the beads. Illumination is simply done with a simple and cheap LED, and what is important is that we have motors here that allow us to move the magnets, so we are changing the gradient acting on the bead, and by doing so we change the force by simply moving the motor. What is important here is that the gradient typically varies on distances that are a few hundreds of micrometers, okay? So it means that when the bead will fluctuate, it will have its Brownian motion, vertical Brownian motion, it will move by fraction, few microns, okay? And this distance is small compared to the scale of the gradient, which means that the force that will experience the bead will be constant. And this is the difference between the magnetic tweezers and the optical tweezers, is that with the optical tweezers, the position of your bead is fixed at the center of the trap. Okay, if you move the center of the trap, you are going to move the bead. Here we work with a constant force, and if there was no attachment, if the DNA breaks, then the bead will move toward the magnet. Okay, so this makes some difference in the way you analyze the data and in the simplicity that you may analyze them. So it makes some difference, and it's important because the experiments that you can perform are not exactly the same in both cases. So most of the time, since it's more convenient to work with constant forces, it's quite often that people add a feedback loop on the system to work with constant force. So they do measure in real time the force and they adjust the position of the laser beam in order to keep the force constant. Okay? Which means that in principle, here the detection can be quite fast, but since you need to measure something and to put a feedback, this reduces the time response of your apparatus. This is an experimental tool. Okay. So what we have where we be where we do have the force, we have a polymer here and the extension is going to be there. Because this bead has some body of motion, after some point it will be in another position. And I should take another turn. It's going to be simpler. And so we'll have a displacement here, delta x. So we'll have, so if we put on the bead here with the force F, it means that here we have a force that is along the polymer that is exactly compensating the other one. So here we have a force that is about the same force. And so it means that when you have the Brownian motion, you have this force that will have a component on the x-axis, here on the x-axis. And so it means that you will have a projection here that is going to be F times sine of this angle alpha. This is going to be the same as this one. That is about F times alpha. That is about the tangent alpha, because we assume that the angle is small. And so it's going to be F delta x divided by the extension. So because there is a Brownian motion, we move from the equilibrium position and we have a restoring force in the equilibrium position that is proportional to the displacement. So here, once again, we have something that is like the spring and the stiffness. Is about F divided by R. Okay? So if you have a spring, once again we are at equilibrium, we can use the equipartition theorem. And so we can write that the fluctuations are equal to 1F ABT. So you're on the microscope, so you can measure the position and you can measure the extension. So by doing so, you have an access to the force if you measure the fluctuation. So in our system, we can measure the force simply by measuring the amplitude of the fluctuation and the extension of the beam. Okay? So it's quite a simple method to do this this measurement. Okay?
So this extension you get out of the focusing sample, I mean, or?
So, can you see that I'm not sure it's not so... This is a B. In our system we can change the focus point that we are looking at. Okay, so on the camera we change the objective position, vertical objective position, and then we are looking at different planes and we get different images for the B. So here we have a bead that is quite small, and you see that when we change the focus point, so here is the focus point, here we increase by 2 microns, here we increase by 4 microns, and so you see that you have beads that have rings that are bigger and bigger. Okay? So by measuring the size of the rings, we can measure the vertical position of the bead. Okay? There is a question that you ask yourself. What is the limit of the displacement that you can get? Okay? Before going to what is the resolution that we have in the vertical position, what do we expect for the resolution, the spatial resolution in the plane? When you were taking some optics classes, the professor told you you cannot resolve position by better than a fraction of the wavelength. Okay, here this is not what you want to do. What your professor or what you did teach to the students is that you cannot distinguish between two points that are distance by distance that is a fraction of the wavelength. Okay, this does not mean that you cannot get the position of the center of one spot with a resolution that is better than this one. Okay? So what we do here to get the xy position and the resolution that we get on the force is that we take the average position of an envelope. Okay? What will be important is the signal comes from the number of photons, and we can get many photons here. And so the resolution can be down to 1 or 2 nanometers. Okay? Even though we are using an optical system, we can get a resolution that is close to a nanometer. Okay? So people now do that with single fluorescent molecules. Okay, this is what people call the super resolution microscopy. But people doing micromanipulation do the same thing for I would say almost 20 years. Okay? What is difficult in that case is that the signal that they have, the number of photons, is very small. Okay? So then you need good detectors to be sure that all the photons that are going to be emitted by your fluorophore, by your bright molecule, has to be collected and used to get the signal. Okay, so we have an horizontal resolution, and vertically we have almost the same. Okay? This technique, okay, by using rings, has almost the same resolution. It's a bit worse, but it's almost the same, a few nanometers. Okay, so we can have access to the force, we can have access to the equations. This in itself would be sufficient, but I decided I would present you another analysis of this problem because you can get access to another force. The bit that we are studying, as I said, has a boundary of motion. It means it's equation of motion, you have the inertia, you have the spring constant, because we have the restoring force to the equilibrium position, and on the force that is acting is also the friction on the beam, okay, because you have some viscosity. So here you know that the coefficient is proportional to r, to eta, at least at low Reynolds number, and you have a coefficient here that is 6 pi for sphere. In principle, this is a sphere that is far from the surface. Okay? Here we have a sphere that is 1 micron that is a few micron from the surface, so there are corrections. And so it's possible to find this correction, we call the Paxton's correction. And if the bead has some boundary motion, it's because there is a random force that is acting on the system, and this is the so-called tangent force. So for a moment we are going to forget the spring, and we are going to consider the equation of motion of B, inertia, it's the viscous friction and the non-time force. So what you find in textbooks is that for sure, because of the isotropy, because we work in water, so in isotropic medium, this force on average is going to be zero. And if you look at the correlation in time, so the average value of the product of the force at the time times the product of the force at the another time, depends only on the difference in time. And in fact, there is no correlation. In the hypothesis that people usually make, and that's valid up to very high frequencies, there is almost no correlation. What interests me is to get this number here that will be related to the amplitude of this number. So you can solve this equation, this is a standard thing that you can find in textbook. If you forget initially for this force, you get a simple differential equation, you get the relaxation with the time constant that is given by this specific time tau that corresponds to the ratio of the inertia to the friction. So now if you vary this constant, you have this general solution for the problem. And the problem that we face is that we don't know exactly what is this value. Okay? So, but what we know is that because we are at equilibrium, so we can use once again the equipartition theorem, we know that 1/2 of the mass times square root, the root of the square, sorry, of the speed is equal to 1/2 kBT. So this is given by this relation. But we can calculate this with this equation, we can calculate the autocorrelation function, and then when the time goes to infinite, we get this value. So trust me, you can find that in textbook or in the lectures that you took a few years ago. So where A here is what characterizes the amplitude of the management force. So with this and the equipartition theorem, we can get the value that tells us that A, the amplitude here of the correlation function, is related to KBT and to the viscous term. So here I use gamma as 6 pi for a sphere far from a surface, but gamma should be modified if you are close to the surface. Okay? So this gives us a specific force. If you consider the force that arises for the previous calculation, you get this value. Here we have a so we have the square of the force. Okay, so we take the square root of this one, and what you get is something like a force divided by a square root of Hertz. Okay? Why can't we get simply a force? We cannot get simply a force because on average the force is zero. So it has no specific value. What we do, what has some meaning, is that you have your bead, your object that is in solution that has received some charge with solvent molecules, okay? So the average sum is zero, so what you do is you sum the square of those, okay? But if you sum the square of those, you will have more and more shocks, okay? So the values that you will get will depend on the time that you acquire, okay? That you look at, okay? Because you sum the square of them, so you sum positive terms, and so you will have more and more of them. So this is why the result that we get is something like a force divided by some specific time, okay? So maybe it's interesting to calculate to get an amplitude of this force. So let's see what is the lengthening force on a sphere that is 1 micron. So we know 2 KBT, we had yesterday, 21 joules. Okay? 6 pi, this is going to be 20. Okay? What is eta? Eta for water, does someone has a number? No? No one has a number. It's important when you go to the swimming pool. Who is swimming here? Nobody is swimming. -3. Okay? So this is in the standard international unit system. I always forget who is quasi, who is quasi, factor of 10 to the 3 between the two, but this is correct. And with that, 1 micron, so 10 to the minus 6. So, 4 times 20, this is going to be 80, 160, times 21, 3, 4, 9. Am I right? Okay. So I'm going to take this as 10 to the minus 28. Which means that what interests me, it means that for during 1 second, the typical force is about 10 to the minus 28. I take the square root of that, and it's going to be 10 to the minus 14 piconewtons. Okay? So if you take an object that is about 1 micron, okay, during 1 second, the typical force acting on it during 1 second is 10 to the minus 14 piconewton. Okay? That's the minus 40 newtons. Mm-hmm. A bacterium is typically 1 micron size. Okay? Its weight is 10 to the minus 40 newtons. But every second, it receives shocks from the water molecule that are exactly the same amplitude. Okay? Now just think, the next time you are going to swim, Okay? Every second, you receive shocks that correspond to a force that is about your weight. Okay? So this will make a difference for you. Okay? There is a big difference between bacteria and us. We have much more muscles, so we can resist, for sure. But what is important is that the value that is very different is the Reynolds number. Okay? They have a typical size, they have typical speeds that are very small, and so then the Reynolds number is small, and so the effect of friction is very important. For us, who are much bigger, the speeds that we can swim are much higher, so the Reynolds number is less important, and so for us, inertia is important. For bacteria, it's the friction that is important. Okay? This is a big difference. Okay, so I made this recall of statistical mechanics just to remind you about this number. The forces are quite small, but if you compare the forces that are involved at this scale, it can be quite important. So now, treating the body in motion, so of the bead that is attached to the spring, even though it's simply an effective spring, you can do that in the Fourier space. It's much better because here you have a function that in a way or another was related to a delta function, so it's not very easy to track. It's easier if you use a Fourier transform of that. And this, in the end, gives you a power spectrum from the amplitude of the fluctuation that is a constant related to the stiffness of the spring, that is related to Kt, that is related to the viscosity, and otherwise, that gives a term that reminds you the filtering of an RC circuit. Okay? So the system that we have is, we have something, a spring, that moves in a dissipative medium, and so it's the same thing as looking at a capacitor with a resistor. And so since the friction is important, it means that the friction will be important, so the resistor is important, and so you get something that is like a Bode diagram, where you have initially a constant voltage, and then you have a decrease because you are filtered by the resistor. In other words, you can move slowly in water, but when you move quickly, you want to move quickly, you are filtered because you dissipate your energy. Okay? This is what tells this spectrum, this experimental spectrum. Here are some different experimental results. So we see that the amplitude of the curve is proportional to the inverse of the force. So the amplitudes are large. You have a large body in motion at low force. And when you increase the force, then the body in motion is smaller. This is quite nice because what is difficult to measure are very small forces. But if you have very small forces, the amplitude is large. So the smaller the force, the bigger is the amplitude. Okay? Which means it's easier to measure. Okay? So this is why it's an interesting tool, because you can easily measure very small forces. Here you see we went down to 10 to the minus 14 newtons, but we could go even lower. The only limit that we have is that at some point the extension of the polymer, because we are reducing the force, is getting close to zero, and so the bead now interacts with the surface. This is the limit that we have. It's not an intrinsic limit because we cannot measure very small forces, as it would be the case in optical tweezers, but it's simply because we have this experimental problem. Another point that is interesting and that people use in optical tweezers, where you get almost the same equation, is that here you have a typical frequency here that appears here on this curve that is related to the stiffness of the spring divided by the dissipation term. Okay, so we have a typical frequency. By looking at the power spectrum like this, we know that the acquisition that we must have must be longer so that we can get not only this value, but we may get also this value. So it means that if we want to measure precisely our system, the force, we need to be able to detect this better frequency. And people using optical tweezers and that do measure force, what they do usually is that they calibrate the stiffness of their tweezers by measuring the position of this corner frequency. By knowing that, since they know the dissipative term, they can have access to the stiffness of the spring. Okay? But presented those equations, even though it's very technical, because it's used as I said, in other micromanipulation techniques, and it's quite good, I think, to recall what is the amplitude of the large electron. Okay? Now, before moving to proteins, I would like to add some elements. In the current that I did present, I told you that if you negatively twisted the DNA, you could create a new structure. I told you that if you positively supercoil the DNA, you may also induce another structure with the bases that are outside. I didn't present you what's happening when you increase the force on the DNA molecule. We know that if you pull very strongly, at some point the DNA will break because you are going to have a force that is strong enough to break a covalent bond. But what people have observed, and this was in 1996, there were two papers back to back in Science, is that at some point, so the curves that I did present you were something like that. Okay? They stopped here. What people have observed is that when you go up to a force that is about 100 and between 80 and 100 piconewton, then you have a large extension that occurs. Okay? You have a large change of extension, and once again, you change a parameter here. When you change the force by just a little, it's just as if you were having, you change slightly the temperature and you change the state of your system that goes from gas to liquid. Okay? So here we change not the density but the extension. And so here there is a new structure that appears when you pull strongly on the molecule. So DNA has a complex phase diagram. You under twist, you denature. You over twist, you create this structure with bases outside. And if you pull strongly, you have a new structure that appears. Okay? That is called sDNA for stretched DNA. So you have a phase diagram for DNA that is not that simple, and if you take some specific sequences, you may have also other things that may appear. I'm going to go quickly on this point. In the phase diagram, the control parameters that you have are the torque and the force. I told you how to measure the force because this is quite simple. Measuring the torque is much more difficult, and I'm going to present you briefly the techniques that were used. You are going to see some of them, I think, next week with Alinarovich and Dunlop. The simplest way is you take a bead that you take in optical trap. You take another bead, so you have a dumbbell, you take the other one on a pipette. You can rotate the pipette easily, okay? You place it on a rotary motor, it will rotate. And then in the middle of the DNA, you attach a very small bead. If you have a flow, you are going to rotate your bead, your DNA. But since you have a flow, the drag here means that this bead will not rotate. Okay? So you are going to generate a torque inside the DNA molecule. Once you arrive at the number of turns that you wanted to add, when you modify the linking number in the way that you wanted, now you can stop the flow. So now the bead will be the small one will be submitted to a torque, and it's going to be in a viscous medium. Okay? So we know that from Stokes, but you know that you have the force in this condition that is proportional to the speed. But you have the same relation, you have the torque that is going to be proportional to the angular speed. Okay? So by measuring the angular speed of the rotation of the small bead, you have access to the torque. It's not a direct measurement that you can do in real time, but it allows you, once you have prepared the DNA, if you assume that the torque is constant, then you may detect the rotation speed, and so you have access to the torque. And so if you look at aerodynamic textbooks, you have the coefficient here between these. Here is an experimental curve from the group of Carlos Bustamante, who developed this technique. He twisted the molecule and measured the angular velocity that is plotted here in green. And so you see that you have a constant velocity because here he pulled and over twisted the molecule, so he created the structure with the bases outside. So I told you that at some point the torque in this region is expected to be constant because you created a new structure. Once the torque is not high enough so that you can induce the structure, you go back to the bDNA. And then you will have the elastic constant of the bDNA that will occur. I told you that in this regime you should have a torque that is proportional to the speed. This is to the proportional to the angle. this is what's happening in this region, and here you are relaxed, there is no more torque into the molecule. So by doing so, you have access to the torque inside the molecule in the different conditions that you may control. You can add some more turns, or you can rotate. So you have an alternative with magnetic tweezers with a different configuration of the magnets. Initially, in the configuration that you present, the magnetic field was in this direction. Okay? With a nanular magnet like this, the field is in this direction. So the torque exerted by the bead is not strong, and so the DNA can relax exactly the same way as the experiment with the friction works. So it's possible, keep in mind that it's possible to measure the torque in this way. And you are going to see that it's possible to do that with optical tweezers next week if you use a material that has some anisotropy. So I'm switching that. So you end up with a phase diagram for DNA. You can control the torque, you can control the force. So here you have the BDNA, okay, the standard DNA that may be supercoiled or not. Here in this region, you may form some pDNA, the DNA with the structure, with the basis outside. Here you form the structure with where the DNA is overstretched. And here, this is a region where you have the DNA that is denatured, and maybe it's a left-handed structure. Okay, so you can plot the phase diagram for a single molecule like that, just like you would do for water. Instead of placing the force and the torque, you could place the pressure and the volume. Okay? I would like to finish this lecture by presenting some experiments that I find quite interesting, atypical. So this was done in the group of François Allemand in the École Normale in Paris. We know that when we stretch a negatively supercoiled, so we want to untwist the DNA molecule, we generate a region that maybe does not look like that, but where the bases are broken. They are broken, but we know that if here we have an A, here we have a T, if here we have a G, here we have a C. Okay? When you pull back, this will close. What you can do also is to have a molecule where at some place you will have something that is going to be an A, a T, a C. So here you will have a G, here you will have an A, here you will have a T. What do I want? Here I can place an A, okay? I can place a T, I can place a C, here I can place a T, A, G, okay? J. Okay. If I take a molecule that I prepare to be like that, now I start to uncoil it. Okay, I will get a structure like that. But with the design of a molecule, here, this base will be able to bind on this one. This one will be able to bind on this one, and this one will be able to bind on this one. And you have the same thing here. So then you can form a structure like this one. You are going to rotate to denature, and if the bubble denaturation appears in this region, at some point you may nucleate something like that. Okay? And this structure is called a hydrogen junction, so it's something that occurs in vivo, even though here it's purely artificial. What is going to happen now, if once you have created the structure, you continue to rotate, what you are going to do is that the branches that you are going to form are simply going to increase. Okay? And each time you are going to add one term, you are going to transfer the equivalent of a helical pitch that is in this direction, and you are going to transfer it in the branches that are here. Okay? So each time you are going to rotate by one term, you are going to transfer, I told you it's 10.5 bases of one term, you are going to be transferred in the branches. Okay? So in the experiment, here you simply have the mechanical properties, you do not denature the DNA, it's at low force. If you increase the force, you start to denature. The extension doesn't change that much as I told you, but here, now you nucleate the structure, this one, okay? And now each time you turn, we transfer the DNA from there to there. And so here we have a slope that tells you how many bases are involved in one term. Okay. So it's a mechanical way of measuring the helical pitch of DNA. The good point is that it's not something that is the traditional way to do some crystallography, okay, where the conditions are not so well controlled. I mean, they are controlled, but they are not natural solutions. Whereas here, you have a DNA molecule that is in water and that is having a normal behavior. So the only difficulty then to get to the helical pitch is that here, you start from a given point. If the force is different, you will start from a lower point here, so the slope will depend also on the initial force that you start with, okay? But this is related to the warm light chain model, so you can correct that and extract the helical pitch of such an experiment, okay? So it's quite a funny way to get access to the structural element by playing on the mechanical properties of DNA and playing with an intelligent way of designing an experiment, okay? I will finish this morning lecture by presenting you another experiment that was done in the same group that was reproduced later by the group of Michel Wong doing something else that we described this afternoon. Is that instead of pulling the two extremities of DNA, now you may say a DNA is made by two strands and I can pull on each of them. So what you are going to do is to pull on the two extremities of a zipper. Okay? If then you increase the force, you know that here you have hydrogen bonds that are strong bonds but not that strong, so you may expect that after a given threshold you may break the bonds. Okay? And this is what's happening. You pull up to a force, well, I don't have the value here, that is about 10 to 15 piconewtons, okay? Let's say 15 piconewtons. So you pull with your tweezers, and at some point, I don't have any zipper except the one that I cannot use.
Do you want to
use
one of my
purse? Yeah, maybe I will take my jacket. I'm afraid it might not be the correct size for me, but. So the experiment is, you start, for sure it's not the correct side. My belly, okay, so what you do in the experiment, I don't want to break it, okay. It's great. Is your purse better?
I don't want to break that either.
I don't want to break it. So basically, you know that if you pull very strongly, you may detach and break all the bonds here.
Yeah, I can do it this way.
Okay.
It works.
Have a look at Robin's burst. It's, you see? This is what the experiment is doing. Okay? You have to pull with a given force, okay? It doesn't open immediately. If you don't pull that strongly, it will not open.
It's a little bit bumpy too, I hear. Quick.
So you need some force to start to open. I remind you that in DNA, you have 80 bases linked by 2 hydrogen bonds, and for GC you have 3 hydrogen bonds. It means that the force required to open the 80 region will be small, okay? While the force required to open the GC-rich region will be higher. So if you can control the force, you can pull on the zipper. You start to break, you feel that you break because you lengthen the distance between your attachment points. Okay? If the force is small, you know that you have 80 bases. If the force is higher at least, you know that it's going to be GC. Okay? So, from a mechanical stretching experiment like that, you have access to the sequence. This is the first problem. You don't know which side is the A or the T. It could be in the open. What is the second point? The second point is that it's more difficult to open the GC regions. Okay. Now, let's imagine I'm going to stretch a molecule. This will be equivalent to giving more heat on this side. Okay. I want to find GC rich region. I increase the force. Increase the force. And then it's difficult. I have to go back to stop it if I have 80 rich regions that are easier to open later. Okay? So here you have a stick slip mechanism, and here inside the DNA molecule you have the same kind of problems. You start to open, you open easily 80 rich regions. You know you have 80. You don't know on which side is A, on which side is B. Okay? But at some point you find a GC rich region. Then you increase the force, and then it opens. But if it opens, the GC rich region will open behind. But you know that if you have an AT rich region later, it will immediately open. So you have then to reduce the force to stop the opening and to start again. Okay? So you are facing an experimental problem that you don't have the time resolution that is good enough, but at least it tells you that in some region for a given amount of bases, that is typically a few hundred, as in the latest results, where you know that you have an AT rich or GC rich region. You do not have access to the sequence, but you have an access on the richness of AT or GC in a given region. Okay? So you can model this, and the theory works quite well. So if you want, there are many papers on that. And I think I'm going to stop that, because then we are going to add proteins on such a system, and this is what I'm going to talk about this afternoon. Okay? Good discussion.
You need a special kind of sequence in order to get that unwinding inside. How reliably does you find that in your system, or is that selective, or you also need to worry about that?
In this case it's quite simple. When you prepare the molecule, this is called a palindrome, something that you have in one direction and the other one. So you take a sequence and you take exactly the same one, you reverse,
okay.
And you have it in this direction.
Okay.
So when you do it, it's simple. In real life, there are some palindromes and the structure do appear. They do not expand on such distances as it is here, but it's possibly something that people have seen.
We know from mechanics that sometimes it's not just a force but a stress that matters for fracture. When you're breaking something, there's a concept of stress intensity factor at the tip of a crack. And we also know from experience that if you're trying to tear something, if the crack is long to begin with, it's easier to tear it further. How does that mechanics come into this process? Because it's not just a force, it's a stress. So like to begin pulling apart is much harder. Once it's already started, it's easier to pull.
So here, if you open the zipper like this,
mm-hmm.
you have to pull, you have to exert a force that is 15 piconewtons, something like that. Okay? To open it.
Breaking the first
If you want to, then if you go in the opposite direction, if you want to break the hydrogen bonds, you need to break on all the molecules. And then the force to stretch to the molecule is much, much, much higher. So it depends on the way you pull on the molecule, that's true. But since here you have something that is very flexible here, it's not that difficult. I mean, in the end, you finish between a line between your attachment points and the point where you are pulling on. Okay? So you cannot play that much with the configurations here.
Okay. My other question is, every time you get this breakage, there's some energy released. Can you listen and hear the difference between the weak bond and the strong bond? Is there a vibration that you can detect besides feeling it in the pulling arm?
Energy will be released, so it's gonna hit somewhere, okay?
Can you hear it? Like, is there some way to sense the vibration or the sound?
No.
There will be vibrations in the string, and there will be vibration in the fluid.
Yeah, but they might be related to frequencies that are not accessible, okay? Because relaxation time scale at the molecular level are quite high.
A
the other problem that you face in this experiment is that the more you pull, the more you have single strand, and single strand is very flexible. Okay? So it's just as if you wanted to pull on something, you take tweezers, it's easy if the tweezers are rigid. If now you start to pull with elastic, rubber, then it's going to become more difficult to control the force. Okay? So the resolution, you have it close to the beginning of the opening, it's much more difficult later.
Yeah, but the elastic is a guitar string. That's the thing. I have the feeling that the vibration of the vibration of the free strand might hold the information.
Yeah, but I think that as you are at the molecular level, there will be modes that are not so easy to get information from. Mm-hmm.
So I just want to ask you about the experiment that you mentioned yesterday that was done, I think, at Delft with the plectonine dynamics.
Yeah.
So they measured that these things happen on two different time scales. One is a diffusion and then the other one is sort of spontaneous popping of the plectonine. I know that theoretically there was a big debate about finding sensible models for that.
I mean, you can write as many theories as you want. At the end, you have the experiment, okay? So if you don't have a theory for the experiment, you have to find a good theory.
Would you say that that has happened? Or is there agreement that people have identified the right theoretical mechanism behind that?
I'm not sure. I mean, as you said, there are some controversies and people do something that are feasible, some are not. I mean, here is the experiment, and so all the models, this is a traditional way physics works. You have experiments that decide whose theory is the best, at least for something.
Thank you very much.